Good evening, everyone. It has been a long day of science, so I would like to ask you to close your eyes for a moment and imagine Philadelphia, 1956. The world is still in black and white. There's no color, shades of gray. There's no PowerPoint. Imagine 1956. 60 years ago, our forefathers met and debated matters of science and technology in heterogeneous catalysis. Two of the elders, Hugh Taylor and Eric Rydell, were asked to watch over the slightly younger children as they traded stories about their science and as they bragged and bickered about their new toys. All this happened in black and white, without PowerPoint. Imagine. The meeting was modest in size, made so by the few practitioners of catalysis at the time, and by the significant barriers in language and in travel. We know it now as the first ICC, but back then it was the ICC, without any idea that a second one may ever take place. That gathering blazed the trail that brought us here today. It became, in time, one of the distinct reference points for our discipline. Our ancestors met and they imagined a future in which the collective knowledge marched alongside spectacular successes in the practice of catalysis. They imagined a future in which we gather regularly to share knowledge, to bridge intellectual gaps, to advance science and its practice in the area of catalysis, and to celebrate the achievements of our colleagues, as we have done this week, just as they imagine it. We have met every 4 years ever since. These ICC meetings have chronicled the challenges and the successes as catalysis was called over a long period of time to tackle some of the most enduring and formidable challenges faced by society, to improve the quality of life without any endangerment of the environment or the well-being of future generations. Today is no exception. We're called again, but the urgency of the challenges may seem greater and the hurdles more daunting. I am certain that the challenges and the hurdles seem as large and as daunting to those in that meeting in 1956. Yet today we know more. We understand nature a little bit more clearly. We own sharper and more diverse tools. And we share a time of unparalleled clarity, maturity, and perspective, and also a time of rapid intellectual growth in our catalysis field. It is a great time to be young. It is a great time to be 30 years old. I can only imagine what so many of you, half my age, we'll get to accomplish after I'm done. We reminisce today about the past. Some of you will meet in a moment some of your distant ancestors for the first time. We reminisce, however, with a view towards the future, a future that we can only imagine. We trust that the young ones among us will turn our imaginings into realities that we could not possibly imagine today. As I collected the materials that you will see shortly, I ponder how much of today was actually imagined 60 years ago and how accurately it was imagined. I expect, however, that it was the act of imagining itself and not its details, that it was the rules and the methods in the search for truth rather than the truth found, that it was the concepts and not the examples, that this is what turned the future that they could not have possibly imagined into our present today. They charted a path designed to capture unintended consequences and the benefits of each serendipitous success, a journey to a destination that becomes obvious only as we arrive at each station along the way. They left us the concepts and the methods, a way of thinking, a way of asking questions They gave us models of scholarship, of statesmanship, and of friendship. Their images and words are shown in a short video. A video that I will introduce first by saying that it was made by dedicated, well-meaning amateurs. This video includes some of our most distinguished colleagues over the years. It is interspersed with a chronology of the 16 ICC meetings. It also excludes some many deserving colleagues without regrets and for the sake of brevity. It shows a few short fragments of our collective family history. It is in that spirit that we would like to show you this video, about 10 minutes, and then I'll make some final remarks. Could we have the video, please?
Experiments started, perhaps just for the fun of it, or to satisfy scientific curiosity, often lead to unexpected, useful results in fields that could not have been predicted.
Okay, what do I do with the carbon monoxide? No hood anywhere near. So I took a cork borer, carborundum powder, and carefully drilled a hole, small hole in the window pane, and put a tube out. Taylor came around, looked at it, and said, "Who did this?" "I did, sir." He looked at it, he never said anything more. When I wasn't using it, I just put a cork in it. And some years ago, I happened to be in the lab, and the cork was, and the hole was still there.
Any good catalytic chemist knows that the first thing one has to consider is the thermodynamics of a reaction, because much time has been wasted trying to get catalysts which carry out reactions that are not thermodynamically possible.
There's no one common solution to all of these problems in catalysis, and I still believe in the dictum of Herman Pines that if you want to understand catalysis, you got to study a catalytic reaction.
That is, if component A is adsorbed more strongly than component B, then as the liquid penetrates the pores, the more strongly adsorbed component will be adsorbed on the surface preferentially. And so during the process of introducing the solution into the pores of the support, you get a sort of chromatographic separation.
I think it's always an adventure to ask a question and to enter a new field where you don't know the answer in advance. And if you then get an answer, and if this answer is really surprising, this creates a great joy, yeah, always.
Finding that I mentioned, in that case, the most excited.
Some new tools began to be introduced in catalysis.
Regularity of the pore sizes and so on just was too tempting to ignore.
I'm going to tell you about some of the things we've been doing, looking at the integration of surface science methods into the study of catalysis. I need not tell this group that metal-supported catalysts, for example, very complex materials, very difficult for us as surface scientists to apply many of the techniques. I mean, you can do.
Doing H2D2 exchange at 77K on magnesium oxide. In fact, this to me was probably one of the first in situ EPR study in catalysis.
Holland, of course, has always been very, very heavily interested in catalysis. And
able to stabilize them because, as I said, finally they die.
I hope the well-meaning efforts of the amateurs have entertained you at least for a little bit, and I hope that the images and the words will cause us to reflect, to imagine a future guided by the past, to see our discipline as it has evolved from the enabling tool box of spectacular technologies into the rigorous scientific discipline that it is today. That growth has always involved a covenant among generations, the passing of the scriptures and the teachings to those who shall inherit the land. In case the message is not clear, you, the young ones who are here for the first time at the ICC, for the first opportunity to see your ancestors at first sight, you are the ones that shall inherit the land. You shall inherit the discipline, and you will carry on forward to do things that we cannot even imagine today. But imagine the future. Imagine it as a journey that is traveled well, not as a specific destination. Our forefathers did not predict our presence, but they charted the path, so that we would not get lost along the way. Thank you for listening. Stay young and continue to imagine.